don't really want to get picked off like that. But one thing to factor in, will the Akai be taken away?
Yeah, I don't know. I think they might want to consider getting rid of these bigger playmakers overall. Like, they just want to make sure they don't have to deal with it. Unless Torak is ready to... unless Torak has something in mind. Like, they tried to take triple purifies just now just to make sure they don't get punished. Like, even Leomar was still struggling to get out of certain situations because they couldn't deal... because he couldn't deal with the Akai, even with a purify because they sent three members there. So, I don't really know.
Well, of course, it's something that we really gotta slowly ponder about. And now, heading in towards that sort of second man, well, we talked about how it wouldn't be ever seeing this sort of game two as well as game number one. Now, Todak's turn to make a move. They've already gotten some great options being left out in the open. So, there's still the Grok, which most likely they are trying to utilize as well. Now, will Sunspark here remove the export? I feel like they should.
They might consider. Now that they're on red side, they might want to consider getting rid of the X1. But they did get rid of the Esmeralda the last time, so I'm not too sure about that. They're kind of thinking on it. If they get rid of the X1 or the Esmeralda, it's both understandable. But you're giving it over to Todak, and I think they might not first pick the Esmeralda. You know what? How about not getting the option?
Well, even better in that sort of sense. Now, X-Ray here. Of course, it's both for choice. It's really about what they really want to prioritize here, whether it's the fighter, the tank, or even that sort of mage that we talked about as well.
Kufra.
Now, we've also missed out Kufra being left out in the open. Now, Todak's going to be getting themselves that sort of pick that every one of these teams have been looking out for. But that will mean that Sunspark will immediately, instantaneously, without even thinking twice, locking Hylos as well as X4.
Yeah, overall, I think the Kufra is going to be a really big pick here. So far, it's been 100% pick ban overall. And we've seen Todak play in the MPL. They are proficient with it. Right now, Sunspark have to ask the big question, like, oh boy, looks like we're going to have to take Purify again.
Oh, yes, indeed. Well, Todak, of course, maybe this is about time that they actually steal off that Akai as well. So perhaps that will be great. But now, we'll totally... didn't see that Valor pick coming in, and now it will be pulling off this sort of a strat. And Moon, Kimi, now opting for that Kimi. Now, interesting to note that they're going for this sort of a draft. Well, of course, pretty good damage output overall, but I'm not really too really keen on how they're going to be playing this Kimi out, because they're pretty squishy for now. What they need is a Assault Tank, and they've already taken that Lolita in the hands of Sunsparks.
Yeah. I feel like Todak had to take the Valir so they don't give it over to Sunspark. But then again, Sunspark did have the option to pick it up last game, and they decided not to. So I don't really know. I think this is kind of like, in terms of just like preference, you pick your poison sort of thing. They ban out the carry very early on. It looks like, are they trying to set up for a Grok here? Not so sure, because they know for a fact that Sunspark aren't going to get it, but they could just ban out the Grok for them. They could just ban out the Grok for the second part of the ban phase. Ooh, Diggy this time.
Diggy is definitely one game-changing support that they are thinking of removing. And now we're, of course, seeing a Gushen, which will dive right in to hunt down that Kimi as well as Valir. So, well, high mobility picks as well coming from inside of Sunspark. I'm liking what I'm seeing so far. And that sort of a ban over on the Kimi is definitely as a respect ban towards JP, because JP on that Kimi carry on that previous game was definitely a huge defining factor for their victory as well.
Yeah, I don't know about the Gushen here. I think the Gushen is kind of interesting. They could have gone for the Lunox again, and I think that might have been okay, but again, Valir is a problem, and they wanted to deal with it with the Gushen. Ooh, it's going to be the Masha as well as the Hellcurt, a 1-3, potential 1-3-1 composition.
Wow, I'm definitely not expecting this at all, but we know Chikyu to be pretty good at that Hellcurt. So let's see how he will play this one out. From what I'm seeing right here, there's a lot of split pushing potential coming in from the side of Todak, but if they were to commit to that team fight, I'm not too sure. Is Masha enough to actually front the battle alongside with the Kufra? And how are they supposed to set it up? Because what I'm seeing here from the side of Sunspark is a lot more stable. Even if they were to actually lose a fight or two, they could still slowly wait for that late game to come back up online. And especially with this last pick for Claude, they are definitely going to commit in towards diving right in to secure those kills.
Yeah. Ooh. Locking in the claw instead of the Granger this time round. Is that a smart choice? I think he should be able to do something here, unless the condition has to be if Valier goes down first, because if Claude decides to go in with the Blazing Duet, I think Valier is going to be able to push him away with no issues whatsoever. So I think like there's a couple of conditions that they have to play around just to make sure they have the most efficient amount of damage.
Yeah, I would say that eventually if they solely get themselves into the mid game and if all the right conditions are met, if they could go in for it, like maybe a pickup for two, then maybe by then they would be able to get all these huge items out. But now I'm really torn apart here. I'm not too sure which side I favor most, but from Toadak, it's definitely interesting.
Yeah.
But I'm really looking at their chances in team fights, which I felt like the only thing that I really like is Hellgrid being brought in with the Dark Knight Falls. Sometimes with that sort of ultimate, blinding the enemies, they will be, of course, having a little bit of a communication issue to know where exactly are the rest of the enemies in that sort of a scenario. But from what I'm seeing here, the Claude is going to be pretty much doing a whole lot of that dirty work in towards most of these team fights. Now, of course, let's get in towards the action as we see game two between Toadak versus Sunsparks.
Yeah, I think right now Toadak is kind of in this position where the moment they hit level four, they want to force out a lot more fights onto the side of Sunspark, because again, their level four isn't as strong as you would imagine, because look at it. Rezio, he's not going to deal as much damage with the Blazing Duet as he wants to. JP has the most amount of damage, and Kale is just going to be by himself for the most part. He's not really going to join the 5v5 as often as you would imagine, because Toadak has some superior wave clear.
Well, I really like how they're really switching things up, and this is how flexible Sunspark members are, and they don't really mind of switching things up. And look at that, two masks has been purchased by the side of Lolita as well as Xborg. A little bit of that revitalize coming from E1 as well. So, of course, that's definitely one spell that's going to be pretty much game-changing in terms of team fight. But I'm not too sure. Kufra, not exactly that sort of a hero that likes to stay in one spot.
Yeah, and overall, it's just there's too many factors that's running through my head. There's too many factors. Like, it could easily go wrong, and I feel, oh wait, here we go. We can already see that Moon is dealing good amount of damage to Revelation. He manages to get on out of that skedaddle. Chico's in trouble now. He gets hit by the sword spike. Oh, one more hit. Wasn't able to get that auto attack before the Shadow Blade slaughter came back in. Fuzukin is in trouble. The Rejuvenation is not going to be enough. They trade one for one.
Beautiful one for one. One inside of the jungle and another on the bottom side of the lane as well. And wow, that was a little bit too close for comfort, as we saw Kill VJ almost dropping out as well. But Toadak here, we're responding pretty well with this sort of rotation in towards the enemy's left side of the jungle, was pretty much well effective. Now they're hunting out for another one, and they're trying to take down JP. E1 gonna go in. Oh, with the bouncing ball.
Just well played, E1 and Nanas. Just well played. The bouncing ball just locks him down. He can't do anything.
Look at that.
He wants to get out of there, but it's just he's not allowed to because of the bouncing ball. It restrains his movement. Every time he uses a mobility skill, it just locks him in place. Well
even
played.
Even if he uses that sort of ability to hop over the wall, the maximum charge was already pointed at him as well. So try as you can, but that was definitely going to be going in the hands of Toadak anyways. And they managed to also secure the turtle at the same time after deleting him off. But wow, this is why a lot of all these teams don't want to even see Kufra being played. But look at Ivan now. He's trying to set things up, bouncing ball being utilized. Ooh. And Renzio forced to use the flicker at such early stages. And here comes Wuzakin.
They're going all in. Ooh, instantly getting found. The Numenor Blast actually pulls them through. E1 is in trouble. He already has to use the Tyrant's Rage. They broke the turret, but they need something to kind of respond. But they don't have the damage. Masha in the backline. She needs to clear this up. She needs to clear this up as soon as possible. X-Ray is trying to run Renzio down. He needs to join the fight as the rest of the team is pulled back.
Moon,
he's trying his best. He's peeling backwards. Chemical Refinement. JP, he's in trouble.
X-Ray,
he has to do it. He's trying to get one last
break.
JP, he goes down. He wasn't able to get the sword spike up, and Renzio makes it out of there. Toadak come up on top. Oh, that was so close. It could have gone either way.
Oh, yes, indeed. And now let's have a little bit of a flashback of what just happened. Starting off, we saw Refusio, of course, being focused down by Toadak. But because of that overextension, they managed to punish him. But after all of that, X-Ray came just in the nick of time. But E1 still managing to actually go in for those really huge knockups, and Renzio had to actually fall back. And we saw Moon, of course, chunking so much damage. He managed to take down the Halas, but JP, of course, stuck between this really awkward position. It's either they go into commit over Moon or try to deal with X-Ray, which of course they will take that chance against the Kimmy.
Man, that was like a super risky 50-50 for both sides. Luckily, Todak did come up on top.
4 kills already for Moon out of this sort of skirmishes. And now look at Fruits again, already forcing out that Rex's pathway, and E1 already soaking out the damage, and instead Fuzaken cannot commit. He's already pretty low, but I'm liking what I'm seeing so far from both sides.
Yeah, I think Sunspark, now they're going to be playing from behind. Let's see how the champions of MPLPH actually play this out, because we've seen them get ahead, we've seen them go even, but we've seen game one as well. It just fluctuates. They could easily just kick back.
Oh yeah, and for the previous game we saw, of course, E1 as well as Moon, they were, I think Moon has been really consistent, but for as for the frontliners, they were taking so much of that sort of hit, but oh, look at that. He just marches right in, but there's no sort of backup coming from the rest of Toda. And now here comes X-Ray joining the table, flickering over the side of JP as well. Arrival on time, but they're still trying to offer that kill. JP escapes, and here comes the last insanity, diving right at the back as the Lolita secures a kill over the matchup. And here comes Dark Knight Vault. Chiku takes down the X-Bar.
3-for-1 Sunspot with superior rotation. Like, wow. I wasn't expecting the cutoff after Tier 1. They really dedicated their resources to make sure E1 as well as X-Ray go down.
Well, I definitely did not see X-Ray getting himself so prepared for this, and how they actually turned this one around was pretty well amazing, because Kill VJ, he went in for that commitment, and with Chiku flickering in towards this battle, that's definitely a one kill being secured, and Sparks right now trying to fight back in this sort of a battle, and they are now only having about less than 2,000 of deficit, so it should be pretty much well enough for them to actually commit, and here comes E1, get clipped off!
Yep, he's going to be going down with no hitches whatsoever. Very good catch coming in from Sunspark. Again, superior rotations. First, it was with the arrival, and this time E1 is definitely disrespecting the opponent. He has to be more careful. Great use of the glorious pathway, just to kind of speed your way up and slow down your opposition from escaping. But X-Ray, he's doing his job really nicely. Even though they gave away 2 kills over to Sunspark, he was able to net himself a turret.
Yeah, and he spots out Renzio right now, cutting across that river. And, I would say that E1 is just buying a little bit of time, but like you said, he's committing a couple of all these mistakes which should not happen at the global stages at all. Well, he's just overextending all by himself. There's no members of Todak to back him up for 2 times straight. And I felt like maybe he's just getting a little bit of that jitters. But now, with that sort of a turtle being spawned up, there's not going to be enough time for the side of Todak to react, because this turtle is being secured by JP.
I think E1 is just trying, he's trying to be the playmaker. He's trying too hard to make the play. He's not waiting for the opportunity. He wants to force it out. He wants to change the tide of the fight against Sunspark. Oh, wait a minute. Is he going to flicker for it? No, they all move away. They already using the maximum impact here, but on the top side, they're trying to steal away the gargoyle. This might be a big fight. Kale, he's trying to make it happen. The last insanity doesn't pop up as much as he wants to, but Fuzuken drops down.
Good.
The glorious pathway as they pull out through. Chiku, he can turn this around. He wants to pick up X point. He gets the concussion instead. Fuzuken is trying to hold his ground. Pops the rejuvenation. Maximum impact doesn't hit, but he still goes down. 2 kills going over to the side of Todak here, and X-Borg makes it out scot-free.
This is what I talked about when the Helka comes into play, that when the Dark Knight Fall hits, they are all in the disarray. Kill VJ opening up the last insignia as well, trying to clear the wave, and now one more turret being destroyed over the top side here. And with that being said, Todak have great control over each of these lanes, and within less than a minute, we're going to see the Lord coming into play.
I mean, this could turn again, because we know for a fact that Kill is using Arrival, so maybe they could force out a fight where it looks like it's going to be a bad, use the Arrival to kind of even out the numbers, or maybe get a numbers advantage in the next upcoming fight.
Well, definitely we'll be able to actually put that to advantage, but now we're seeing great positioning coming from the side of Todak, just waiting patiently, hoping that members of Sunspark would be going in for a little bit of that phase check. But they are too occupied getting themselves over the top side. What is only going to be Fuzaken right here. And if he gets clipped out, there's still the Rush's pathway, and he could possibly run off. But with the one member taken out, then Sunspark will lose out the opportunity. And E1's going to set things up as well. He knows that he's right there. Bouncing ball just to stop him for a little while, but they cannot fully commit.
Yeah, and Lord, man, Ninas is just chunking people out. That's kind of the beauty of Valir here. And uphill, he's trying to make something happen. I'm not too sure what items X-Ray has as of right now, but I think he does have the Corrosive Scythe already. The question is, does he have Windtalker as well? I need to double check the items to make sure, because then that kind of gives him an opportunity. Oh, yeah. He gets caught out. Chiku turns back in. Dark Knight falls. He manages to get the kill. Revelation is now in trouble. They manage to get a double for one. Moon goes down, but Chiku gets two.
There was no reason for them to cut by that corner of the river, and Emily gets punished. Chiku being so responsive after taking that double kill, he's going straight after the Lord. And now let's have another look at how Chiku sets this one out perfectly. And he couldn't even do this without the help of the rest of the members. Toadak.
Yeah, and I think that was just a really good job overall. Monster, it was a good attempt by Sunsparks, but Toadak, I think they played that really, really well, and they kind of disrespected how far ahead Chiku is after those four kills, because, man, he is gigantic.
Yeah, he can definitely hit back home to buy whatever sort of a brand new sports car if he wants, but now look at the items. He's already got BOD as well as Endless Battle, and there's definitely more to come after this. Well, of course, the wings have been bought there by the export.
Oh,
and
my goodness.
Well, it's going to be Moon just trying to actually pull one shot out of the barrel that he has. And that's definitely one buff headed towards the way of Toadak. Well, yeah. Sunsparks have to play it really safely and possibly try to force a sort of a move coming from the side of Toadak and punish them for it.
Yeah, and after getting that initial push, they do get the tier 2. They're going to let Lord die on top side. They're going to keep on pushing. They're going to let the wave push through on top side. They're going to keep on going through. The question is, can they keep... Oh, here it goes. X-Ray's in trouble. Takes a lot of damage. Chiku is at 1 HP. Glorious Pathway is put. Numenon Blast actually locks down the backline. E1, he's holding his ground. He's already used the last insanity here. Nobody has died just yet. E1 is going to sacrifice himself for the team. Masha runs to the top side of the map, trying to find some pressure.
Well, it's only down to Masha, Valir, as well as Kimmy to actually go out there to just slowly force things upon the side of Sunspark for the very least. Well, of course, not many other major objectives other than the towers are in the eyes of Toadak. As we see, the goal swinging in favor of the side of Toadak the entirety of this whole matchup here. But of course, JP looking to change things up. And like you said, that Gushin here, you may not fancy it for a couple of reasons here, but he definitely pulled off some pretty sick plays overall.
Yeah, he is finding some great catches onto Moon. And Moon, so far, oh my goodness, Kyo's in trouble. Chiku tries to predict it, but doesn't find it. But Kyo, he knows he's got, drops the emote just before he goes out. And Chiku with a reply.
Oh my, at least they're having a little bit of fun time. But Chiku instead, getting pinned down, Flicker being forced away. And now, an eye for an eye. Look at him go ahead and pop there. 5 JP. Well, X-Ray says, okay, you can take my member, but I'm going to take your tower as well. Here comes Fuzikin as well as Renzio trying to commit to this. But you know, you cannot outchase this Masha.
Yeah, she's not going to let herself die. She just walks away. 3 health bars still. And right now, they're kind of waiting on Renzio to get all of his items. He buys his Athena shield to kind of protect himself against Ninas as well as Moon. Oh, no. This is not looking like a good fight. Ninas bails out of there, but again, E1 in trouble, has to go down. But they actually get the arrival out of the export, and now this kind of opens up the map a little bit more for Masha to play the way she wants to.
That's right, and for Sunsparks here, they're just forcing this sort of a push heading towards the mid lane, and after that, they're gonna camp out for the Lord as well. While of course, JP already forcing a push over the top side here. So they're definitely spot for choice. Now spots out X-Ray. But X-Ray is going to wait for the rest of the members to come right after. Of course, the Valor is going to be waiting at the back as well, while Rafflesia already getting that invade towards the lower side of the jungle.
Yeah, they're just holding their ground. I mean, so far it's looking good for Toadak. I think this is their window. If they force out another fight, they might be able to win this. They just need to make sure that JP doesn't get into that backline and take out Moon or even Chiku at that point in time. Because again, both Moon and Chiku are huge.
Well, Moon and Chiku right here. You saw Moon, of course, playing a perfect game in the previous round. It was almost perfect for this game itself, where we saw Moon the last time that he got a kill, he was deathless as well. So now getting caught out a few times. But you're getting caught out right here. Renzio forced to open up that Blazing Duet. That maximum charge will not land. And Todak here is still trying to open things up over the top side. Well, there will be that immortality in the hands of KillVJ after a couple of minutes here, heading in towards the mid game. And now E1 once again causing a little bit of a flaw, but there is the Lord. They cannot afford to lose any members at all.
Yeah, it really is going to be too difficult. Chiku here, he's just holding his ground. Lord is back up, and now both Sunspark and Todak, they want to contest this.
Well, we're seeing them not really moving all too much of a muscle for the time being, but Masha doing Masha things, just waiting things out and hoping that they will fully commit to a fight, and the Masha will slowly break in towards the top side. And they're sending that export in towards the top, and maybe this is where Todak will try to respond as well, because they know it will be a 5v4.
Great use of the maximum impact there. He doesn't want to walk up and use his range. Instead, oh wait, he's gonna, wait a minute. Is he gonna make it out? Can Chiku make it out? Yes, he can. Yes, he can. Yes, he makes it just in time, having to use his ultimate to escape. But this gives the green light for Sunspark to take it out. X-Spark on the top side of the map, getting chunked out. But again, bottom side, they're gonna lose Lord for this. Can they steal it away? Chiku, he's here.
He goes in for the steal. How is this even possible? Coming from the Kuna, and he also takes out the Gushin as well. They're turning things around, and there's Tamasha pushing them in the top wave as well. And in the blink of an eye, Todak stats that one away. Now down to Rufus as well as Renzio. Renzio doing some spot with rail. And for the side of Sunsparks, they're hanging on the thread. They're trying to defend the tower, and they will have to lose out Ripley's Seal right here.
Oh my goodness, that was such a huge steal, Renzio. He jumps all away. Maximum Impact does pick him up, and now Moon, he's just gonna sit right in front of Revelatio's face. He's not gonna let him go without a fight. Revelatio playing this well, using the chunk, but he goes down at the very end. They have already broken mid inhibitor. They wanna break that one top side, and Kiel, even though he used the arrival to protect himself, this is not looking good for Sunspark. That one steal might have cost them the game. They're going for it. Todak wants to end this.
Todak here will push it into the game tree. They're crashing the base, and the Lord is heading in, and they will push and force this game upon Sunsparks here, who could not defend at all.
Oh my goodness. After E1, he was struggling to perform. He was trying to make things happen. He finally did. He finally decided to be patient, waited for his opportunity, and stole away a game changing, game winning Lord.
Yeah, and of course, we were pretty harsh on him on the early stages of the game, where he was actually committing mistakes after mistakes. But he definitely redeemed himself in the late phase, going in with the drive by as he hops upon, stealing it with. With only very little health, I thought that there will be the retribution to secure it. But of course, Sunspark lost that sort of matchup in a blink of that sort of moment. And now, the MVP, you really gotta give it to Chiku, because Chiku was in that sort of game-changing fight. There was also that triple kill as well as the double.
Yes.
And we saw how they were actually rotating across the map so efficiently. And Sunsparks, this time around, they really got to bow out. And JP, though he did a lot this game, it was not really enough, because he can only focus one target at a time.
Yeah, he trades one for one almost every single time he goes into the fight, and always finds a priority target, or at the very least, chunks out everybody enough to kind of allow his team to play with more space. But overall, this has just been an absolutely insane series here at the M1. Group C started off with a really good game.
Oh yeah, and I'm really glad that we actually woke up really early to the studios for this. And look at E1 here. Of course, he's slowly tanking things out, and he's setting the tempo for X-Ray to come by. Of course, X-Ray flickers in, finish off the kill, and Fuza Ken alongside Renzio. They're going for that chase, but Moon was way too popular.